bourbon, America's sole native spirit. Over time, bourbon has grown to be a central part of the culture of Kentucky. Bourbon has shaped the everyday lives of the people of the Commonwealth for generations. Bourbon especially has played a key role in the history of the bluegrass.
Well, we had quite a few bourbon distilleries here originally. I guess you might say before we were a state. This was Virginia. And back in the 1770s or so, maybe 1780s, we had a distillery that was located on the same site where Buffalo Trace is today. When people first started coming into what would become Kentucky, they always planted an apple orchard or a peach orchard, and that would become peach brandy and apple brandy and that sort of thing. Everybody had their booze, so to speak. And everybody had a still somewhere, just about. So you had a lot of little one-horse distilleries, so to speak, all over the state, as well as Tennessee and some of the other places. But this was a perfect spot because of the limestone and the water that we had in central Kentucky. It just proves really well for whiskey.
Over the years, Frankfort, the capital of Kentucky, developed into the epicenter of a massive nationwide industry. At the forefront of the development was a wealthy local banker and politician named E.H. Taylor.
Colonel E.H. Taylor was just an incredible man when it came to not only creating a fine, wonderful working distillery, clean and immaculate, but he was also a great promoter of whiskey, and he did a great job of that. He's considered the modern father of the bourbon industry. Before him was Jim Crow. Jim Crow actually, he was a Scottish immigrant, and he came to Kentucky in the early 1830s, and he had his own little recipe, which when he died, it died with him. It's no longer with us. But he created this Old Crow whiskey, actually began over in Woodford County with Elijah Pepper and his son Oscar. And these two worked together at the distillery over in Woodford County, Greer's Creek, and Jim Crow was the guy that was their distiller.
Under the leadership of Colonel Taylor and Mr. Crow, the Kentucky bourbon industry reached new heights. Everything about their distilleries was unique. These distilleries, now abandoned, became showcases for the wealthy elites. Both the Old Taylor Distillery, at the time the largest distillery in the world, and the Old Crow Distillery were used by Taylor to attract the celebrity patrons of bourbon through his elaborate system of gardens and fountains located on the grounds.
A lot of people drank this whiskey even before the Civil War. People like Andrew Jackson, Henry Clay, he even did advertisements for Old Crow whiskey. And you had John C. Breckinridge also loved Old Crow, as did John Hunt Morgan, the Confederate leader. Some of the other authors, O. Henry and Jack London and Mark Twain, they all loved Old Crow. It was quite a favorite for many people. As time changed, you get into the Prohibition, which stopped the distribution of alcohol, or at least legally stopped it. There was quite a bit of moonshining going on during those days. But it canceled a lot of business for the whiskey industry and caused some of the smaller industries to actually go out of business because if they couldn't sell it, they couldn't get any money in to continue to operate their business. So 10 years plus of that caused a lot of them to go out. And then when it was repealed in 1933, then you had this big boom of corporate interests getting in and larger companies taking over the smaller distillers, housing them under names like Jim Beam or others of that nature.
Even though the bourbon industry recovered, it was unable to reach its once great popularity. The globalization that followed World War II led to the popularity of new and cheaper beverages. This led bourbon towards another period of decline.
in the 60s, I guess beer became more of the person's choice of drink. It was cheaper, and football was on TV, and it really got a lot of beer advertising. You couldn't advertise whiskey back in those days. So the beer took over, and the whiskey kind of began to dwindle in the 60s and the early 70s.
Today, however, bourbon is experiencing a renaissance. Due to tourism and new effective marketing, bourbon is reaching a new level of demand as a new era of bourbon consumer takes shape.
For me, I've been a Jim Beam for a year and a half. You know, in that short amount of time, I've seen quite a bit of change. They're developing constantly with billions of dollars being invested. Actually, Beam Suntory, which is Jim Beam's parent company, has invested or guaranteed to invest $5 million in Kentucky alone to continue to produce bourbon. It is their number one industry. Jim Beam is the number one bourbon in the world. And Kentucky bourbon sells worldwide like crazy. It's amazing. A $20 bottle of bourbon here in Kentucky, in Japan, where our parent company is selling for over $100 US. That's incredible. And seeing it grow, it's something to really see.
It came back with the bourbon trail that was started. Many of the industries here in Kentucky consolidating advertising together. And it also developed into a tourist thing. People now got their little books out and they check off the distilleries that they visit and everything on the bourbon trail. And you have ghost tours now that have started. The television programs have really skyrocketed attendance. A lot of the bigger distilleries have their own museums. Here in Frankfort, Buffalo Trace has thousands of people go through their free tours every year.
As bourbon sales continue to skyrocket, the future looks bright for the bourbon industry. New technology and marketing techniques are allowing the bourbon industry to move into the 21st century to keep up with the enormous demand.
I think they're going to always make bourbon the same way they've been making it for 200 years because that's what's made it famous. But what's really going to change, I think, is how it's bottled and how it's processed and the number of people that it takes to do it. You know, just in my time there, I've seen bottling lines improve, and, you know, the equipment nowadays has taken away some of the manpower that was required before. I hear stories from the old folks there who've been on for over 20 years that tell me that it used to take 20 people or more to run a bottling line, and now one line can run with about six folks. You know, it's nothing but growing. With a 35% increase in bourbon sales over the last 5 years, according to the Kentucky Bourbon Council, that's huge. And you're going to see change after change.